Hey guys, I'm Logan, the 64th Gear Jammer Skeele, and I was hungry today. So I decided to go hang out at the Broken Wheel truck stop and tell some stories. I'll get to one after the review. One of the legends of the road was Monfort of Colorado. So smash the like button, as I'm sure you've heard of it. And I did another video on a K100 by DCP from Monfort. Go check it out after this video with the link down below. If you've got any stories about Monfort, drop them in the comments. Now, let's go on and talk about a Peterbilt 352 COE pulling a 40-foot vintage Reefer van trailer by DCP by First Gear. I know, this model is of an owner-operator's truck, but it still is sharp in circus wagon colors.
And this is the Peterbilt 352 COE with a single bunk pulling a vintage 40-foot Reefer van for Monfort of Colorado. It is in the famous circus wagon paint scheme. And this truck was done almost right. It was not a company truck for Monfort. It was an owner operator. And he had different wheels on his than this one. But I understand why they did what they did with these wheels. They did as best as they could, but the wheels are wrong from the real truck. And I have seen pictures of the real truck, so I know exactly what it looks like. The rest of it's spot on. It's just the wheels that were wrong. Now let's start off with the trailer. It is a diecast metal 1/64 scale piece by DCP by First Gear. Now the trailer is basically the same as the other one. It's got the Monfort of Colorado on the side. It's got a trailer number up there on the corner of 544, which is on both corners. Thermo King Reefer, same paint scheme, diecast metal. Underneath the fuel tank, it's got a date of manufacture of 1/02/19, so 102nd day of 2019. It's got working rear suspension, air brake canisters on the axle, spare tire, fuel tank, screw down landing gear, all that you would expect from a DCP. It's got opening back doors, and it says the detailed interior, the refrigerated interior, Monfort of Colorado, beef and lamb, brake lights, all that you would expect, 544. Now, each DCP release has had the same exact trailer. Only difference is they put a different trailer number on each trailer. So each trailer really does have a different number, which is really cool. And to see all their releases, grab my free report on, it's a checklist on all of the DCP Monfort releases. It'll show you pictures of all of them and give you the exact specs, truck numbers, trailer numbers, and everything, so you can make sure you find them all for your collection. And this trailer is really nice. It's die-cast. Monfort had a great paint scheme that was very simple back then. Monfort of Colorado on the side. Really cool. The cabs, though, they put a really fancy paint job on. Now I'm going to set this trailer aside so we can talk about the cab. And to do that, I'll screw the landing gear down. Now we have the Peterbilt 352 COE for Monfort. As I said, it was an owner-operator that had this truck, and it was real. It was painted in this paint scheme, but he had painted steel wheels on the rear, and he had aluminums on the front. And they were 5-hole, not 10-hole. It's got the regular grab bar step thing, which is not my favorite, but that's what this guy actually had. It's got Monfort Packing Company, Greely, Colorado. Its ICC number and its other important info on the side of the door. Peterbilt logo way down here under the door where Peterbilt put it. A marker light, turn signal. It's got a spotlight and mirror there. Grab bar and exhaust. It's got some chrome parts, but not all chrome. Painted fuel tank with chrome bands. Up top, fifth wheel is plastic and pivots. It's got a deck plate that's chrome diamond plate, pogo stick with air lines and electric lines on it. It has individual bullet style chrome roof lights that have a little orange paint on them for amber lenses, chrome air horns, chrome breather that comes straight up through the sleeper, and it's got the rooftop air conditioner with a little that's painted in Monfort orange with the black fan. Twin stacks, as you can see, and it's got a decal for the heat shield, and then it's got the 45 miters on the tailpipes coming out of the exhaust. The rear, it's got brake lights, backup lights, and marker lights, and it has mud flaps that are painted black on chrome brackets. Really nice job they did. See the cutout to see into the engine right there, and you can see how the exhaust just sits down into cups, just like the real one. The mufflers are attached to the back of the cab, and then they just sit down into these pipes. Really cool design, so when you tilt the cab, the exhaust goes with it. I'll show you. Watch this. And then you can see how the exhaust, it goes up with the cab, and then it just sits down into those cups. Pretty cool, and it does a good job. Passenger side over here, very much the same as the driver's, only it has this little mirror down by the little window so the driver can see what's beside him. You can see the famous circus wagon paint scheme that comes around. Peterbilt logo. Windshield wipers are molded into the diecast body and tampoed. Then it has hard plastic windows, visor, individual dual style headlights and chrome pods, painted on driving lights, and bumper is chrome. And then it has a chrome grille. And that is the Peterbilt 352 COE owner operator. And this truck doesn't have a truck unit number, but the trailer does, with a 40-foot reefer van. And the trailer number is 544 for Monfort of Colorado, the Monfort Packing Company out of Greely, Colorado. Fast sellout, so good luck finding them on the secondary market. And to find out what all other Monforts have been made by DCP, go on and grab my free checklist with the link down below. And let's go on and get to the story that I have about a Monfort driver.
Man, wasn't that a cool model? Anyway, I said I had some stories to tell, so here we go. I was talking to a driver a few years ago at a truck stop, and he was reminiscing about the good old days when the speed limit was double nickel. He started on about his first trip running for Monfort out of Greely, Colorado. He said he finished orientation at the headquarters in the mid-70s and was ready for his first run. His co-driver on this first run was a very experienced runner. He ran hard and made that trip to New York City pretty short. Now, the guy I was talking to was eager to get his first trip going, but wanted to learn as much as possible about the wild man he was riding with. So, he asked around about him with some of the office staff, and one secretary said, he is a practical joker. And to watch out, as he is likely to do anything and guaranteed to pull something. With that ominous warning, he headed out to find the truck. It was backed into a dock, getting loaded with swinging beef. He walked up to the truck and gave it a once over to see if everything was all right and ready to roll. The truck was a shiny, new Kenworth W9 with a single bunk sleeper. Back then, it was common to hot bunk when team driving. One bed and both drivers shared it. One driving and one sleeping. Not like today with these big sleepers with two bunks in them, one for each driver. Anyway, this sleeper was still a nice luxury for driving. As he told me, when he started out, he ran a 60s Pete with no sleeper. And he found himself spread over the seats on a piece of plywood. He said this truck was such a nice change. Nice sleeper and 3408 cap under the hood. The truck was painted in circus wagon paint and polished up. Man, talk about riding in style. Man, the broken wheel really has great chili. What a time of year for it. So, the truck is ready. He is ready. Now, waiting on his co-driver to show up with the paperwork so they can get on the road. The co-driver, he comes on out and says, "Get in, let's roll." And with that, they both climb in the cab and head out of the yard. Destination, New York City Meat Market. This is a 1,750-mile run on I-80 across the plains where they really make time. Once out on the highway, the co-driver starts giving him another orientation, to which he doesn't pay much attention. He has years of experience behind the wheel of a semi-truck, so why listen to a guy tell him how to do a job he's done for many years? Finally, it's his turn to drive, and they swap seats after dinner at a truck stop in Nebraska. He was driving along, and his co-driver said, "It's time to hit the hay," and crawls back into the bunk to sleep for a few hours. Yes, he is now driving without a chaperone over his shoulder. That makes this trip so much better. A few hours later, they were rolling into Iowa when the co-driver wakes up and says, "It's time to eat and swap places." Since he was hungry, he didn't argue and pulled on off two exits down the highway where the co-driver said there was a great little diner to eat at. Kind of like me right now eating. After eating breakfast, it was time to head back out onto the road to New York. This time, he was in the bunk and the co-driver was behind the wheel. It seemed safe enough, but he was still on edge after what that secretary had said. He didn't want to fully fall asleep, as who knows what this guy might pull on him or when. A few hours later, still in Iowa, he is woken up to a banging on the side of the sleeper. He heard the truck engine whining and the tires singing, so he knew he was still rolling and no one should be banging on the side of the sleeper. But there was that banging sound anyway. Then it was followed up by yelling, "Hey, wake up and jump! She's about to go over a cliff." He said, "Now I'm awake." He figured out that the practical joke time had hit. So he peeked out of the sleeper to see a hand through the window steering as they're going 80 miles an hour down the interstate. No driver in the seat though. It turns out that this wild man had put the truck on cruise control, opened the door, and stepped out on the steps for this prank. The co-driver then drove with his hand through the window and was banging on the sleeper, trying to get his trainee out. Well, he said, "Wild man, I know your game." And he reached over and locked the driver's door and crawled back into the bunk. Now, the co-driver was banging on the door and yelling, "Let me in!" Of course, he couldn't do much about it but yell, and he let the co-driver out there for a few minutes before coming back out to unlock the door. After that, he said the old man thought twice before pulling a practical joke on him as he would call his bluff and up the score. He also said they made a great team. From that day on, it had some more really wild times on the 1,750-mile trip to New York City and 1,750-mile trip back to Greely, Colorado, two times a week. Thanks for watching, guys. Don't forget to go on and watch my other Monfort video with the link down below. And please go on and smash that like button, share this video, and subscribe to my channel. Also, if you've got any stories, personal or otherwise, about the old Monfort trucks, drop them down in the comments. I'd really, really love to hear them. I'm Logan, the 64th Gear Jammer Skeele, and I'll be back soon with some new content and yet another episode of Toy Talks.